This is our grand finale in the book of Colossians. So turn with me one more time to Colossians chapter 4. Colossians chapter 4. We're going to look at these final verses that Paul writes in the book of Colossians. I hope you've enjoyed these past 8 weeks together as we've dug into the Word of God and looked at Paul's letter to the Colossians. Colossians chapter 4. Say amen if you got it. Say wait for me if you don't. It'll be on the screens for you. I'm reading from the New International Version of God's Word. This is what it says. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. And pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Tychicus will tell you all the news about me. He's a dear brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. I'm sending him to you for the express purpose that you may know about our circumstances and that he may encourage your hearts. He's coming with Onesimus, our faithful and dear brother, who is one of you. They will tell you everything that is happening here. My fellow prisoner, Aristarchus, sends you his greetings, as does Mark, the cousin of Barnabas. You've received instructions about him. If he comes to you, welcome him. Jesus, who is called Justice, also sends greetings. These are the only Jews among my co-workers for the kingdom of God, and they have proved a comfort to me. Epaphras, who is one of you and a servant of Christ Jesus, sends greetings. He's always wrestling for you in prayer that you may stand firm in all the will of God, mature and fully assured. I vouch for him that he's working hard for you and for those at Laodicea and Hierapolis. Our dear friend Luke, the doctor, and Demas send greetings. Give my greetings to the brothers and sisters at Laodicea and to Nympha and the church in her house. After this letter has been read to you, see to it that it's also read in the church of the Laodiceans and that you in turn read the letter from Laodicea. Tell Archippus, see to it that you complete the ministry you've received in the Lord. I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. I know some of y'all are wondering, where are we going with all these names and all this long list? You know, we tend to skip over these things sometimes. But this is Paul's final little note. It's like that moment where you say, hey, just before I go, and then you use that opportunity to reiterate and reemphasize what it is that you've been saying, what it is that you want to say. It's those final things, the things that you want to stick with people. This is what Paul's giving us right here. So that's what I want to tag this text today is just before I go. Just before I go, would you pray with me? Father, by your spoken word, the worlds were formed. Now as your word is preached, would you form our worlds to align with your kingdom? Form our character to look more like that of your Son. Take my lips and speak through them. Take our minds and think with them. Take our hearts and set them on fire with love for you. It's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen. A few parting words just before I go. You know, in college, I had a number of classes that required what was called a lab class. In order to sign up for that class, you also had to take a lab class as well. For instance, in music theory, I took music theory, and you had to sign up for music theory and music theory lab. Now, in theory, you'd sit at a desk with pencil and paper, and you'd discuss harmony and counterpoint and other musical concepts, the how and why music works. But when you went to the lab class, you would sit down at a piano and actually work through all those ideas in practice, because music is not simply a mathematical formula to be figured out. It's an experience. It's meant to be heard. It's meant to be played. It's meant to be experienced. And this is how it is with Paul's letter. The apostle wants to inform the thinking and believing of his audience, but being a Christian is not just about checking off a list of right beliefs or good theology, but it's a lived out experience in the real world. And so it is that Paul offers these closing instructions just before he goes and gives the Colossians some responsibility for what they've just heard. He gives them a lab class in seeking the things above. And it probably won't surprise you to learn that the first place that we should go in our pursuit of the things above is to prayer. Paul's encouragement to the Colossians and to us is to persevere in prayer. Look here at verses 2 through 4. It's the outline for the message today. Devote yourselves to prayer. Devote yourselves to prayer. Give your time, give your resources to prayer. Be strong in your commitment towards prayer. I talk to a lot of people, they'll say, well, I pray when I'm in the shower. I pray when I'm in my morning commute. I pray while I'm cleaning the kitchen. That's good. You should pray at all times. That's great. But there is something powerful about giving devoted time to prayer. Take those moments of your day when you're at your most creative, your most energetic. Take the best part of your time, the best resources of your time, and give focused attention to prayer, and it'll make a difference in your life. Devote yourself to prayer. And Paul says, while you're at it, pray for us. You know, Paul's writing from prison, so it's not too surprising that he would ask for prayer. We pray for people that are in prison, but notice what he asked them to pray for. He says, pray that God may open a door for our message. Now, I'm going to be straight with you. If it was me who was in prison and I was writing to you, I also would ask you to pray that God may open a door. But I'd be asking you to pray that God would open the door for me to get out of here. I don't want to stay in the prison. That would be my prayer request, would be to get out of prison. But Paul sees a greater purpose in his persecution. The way he says it, he says, it's for this that I'm in chains, so that I can have this opportunity right here in this prison to proclaim the mystery of Christ. Not a mystery as in a problem to solve, but a mystery as in something that can only be known in the way and time of God's choosing. Paul stepped through that prison door knowing that it was an appointment for him. He stepped into that awful situation knowing that God had a purpose in him. He knew that God wanted to use him right there in that prison in Ephesus. So he says, pray that God would open a door for the message. You know, since this whole pandemic thing started, most of the prayers and prayer requests that I've heard from people is just pray that it would end. Pray that things would go back to normal. You see, in our prison, we pray to get out. But in Paul's prison, he prays to be effective in the situation that he's in. You know, Paul loved his freedom as much as anybody, but he loved his purpose more. You know, I wonder what might happen if we just embrace the moment that we're in. Quarantine and all. Masks and all, if we just embraced it and said, Lord, whatever you're doing in this season, please don't do it without me. What if we unpacked our bags? What if we put our clothes in the drawers and said, hey, you know what? If this is where I am, if this is the season that I'm in, if this is where you have me, then Lord, use me right here. Paul says he's hoping for an open door for the message. It's the same message that got him in prison. In other words, Paul's committed to this message regardless of the consequences that it may bring, because he understands that he can be imprisoned, but the gospel can't be locked up. The gospel keeps on going forward, and it has power even in a prison situation. The gospel still has power to bring new life even in a quarantine situation. Even if you've got to share it through a mask, the gospel still has power. And listen to me, church. The proclamation of the gospel is not just what the preachers do, but it's for the whole church. It's for the whole church. He says that we're to demonstrate the gospel in your walk and in your words. Look here at verses 5 and 6. You know, it was St. Francis who famously said, preach the gospel at all times, and when necessary, use words. You know, I wonder if St. Francis might have been thinking about these very words from Paul. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. If verse 5 starts out, be wise in the way you act. And honestly, we could just stop right there. Because some of us are being emotional in the way we act. Some of us are being impulsive in the way we act. And what we need is some folks that are being wise in the way they act. Paul says we're to be wise in the way we act. We're to have an awareness and understanding of the context that God has placed us in. If we're going to be effective, we need to have some wisdom. And specifically, we need wisdom when dealing with outsiders, when dealing with those who don't believe yet, towards those who aren't here yet, towards those who differ and disagree with us. We need to have wisdom in how we deal with people who are on the outside. I have a question for you today. Do you see opportunities when you see outsiders? Do you see an opportunity when you see outsiders? I remember the 2004 National League Championship, and Carlos Beltran was playing for the Astros back then, and he was like a machine that whole series. He tied Barry Bonds' single postseason records with 8 home runs. He hit one in each of the first 4 games of the National League series against the St. Louis Cardinals, including the game winner in Game 4. He swung at pitches that would have been called balls. I remember this one, and they were showing the replay, and the ball was in the dirt. It was a called ball, but what he took was what looked like a golf swing. He swung at that thing in the dirt and sent it out of the park. Carlos Beltran knew how to make the most of every opportunity. Can I share something with you? The default setting of every church, is to turn in on itself. We create these close-knit communities of believers, and that's good, but sometimes we get so close to each other that there's no way for anybody else to get in. We become all about ourselves and our programs and our facilities and our people. We quarantine ourselves away from the outside world, and we stop looking for the opportunities. We aren't wise. We miss the opportunities. We let pitches sail by. We get struck out looking. Let's make the most of the opportunities that God puts in front of us. Let everything that we do as a church demonstrate the gospel in a way that speaks clearly to outsiders. Now, a lot of Christians seem to think that preaching and playing and singing are the only opportunities to minister. It's the only opportunities to demonstrate the gospel, and everybody else is the technical support. No. Listen, if you're thinking like that, you're going to miss the opportunities when they come up. Can I share with you, making sure the bathrooms are cleaned and stocked and smell nice on Sunday morning, it's an opportunity. Being on a social media team and interacting with folks that are on our video, it's an opportunity. Wearing a mask and holding the door open for people as they come in and greeting them, it's an opportunity. That's our walk. There's opportunities in just the things that we do to show, to act in wisdom towards outsiders. But it's not just our walk. Paul says it's also about our words. He says, let your conversation, the word there is logos. That's more than just the words that come out of your mouth. It's not just rote repetition. It's the root of our word logic. In other words, it's the words together with the thought and intention behind them. He says, let your conversation be full of grace. Our intention in speaking with people is to convey that same grace that we've received. He says, let it be seasoned with salt. Salt is both a preservative and it makes food more palatable. When we speak with grace, we do it in a way that it stays with people. There's something about it that preserves folks when they have grace. And it's attractive. It's not boring. It's not abrasive. It's not defensive. That's part of acting in wisdom towards outsiders. If we make a habit of thinking and speaking winsomely and with grace, we're going to be well-equipped to answer questions from people who are puzzled about our way of life. Act with wisdom toward outsiders. Well, here Paul shifts into some closing greetings. And we a lot of times we kind of skim over these passages. We sort of skip these weird-sounding names. But when the Holy Spirit inspired Paul to write Scripture, he inspired him to write in the form of a letter, which includes all the regular features of a letter, like greetings, to and from some folks that maybe some you've heard of and some you haven't. It's a reminder that you need to find some people that you can lean on, and you need to let somebody lean on you. Find somebody you can lean on. Let somebody lean on you. Look at verses 7 through 9. He talks about Tychicus, who'll tell you all the news about me. He says, I'm sending him to you for the express purpose that you may know about our circumstances and that he may encourage your hearts. He's coming with Onesimus, our faithful brother, who's one of you. You know, you might not immediately recognize Tychicus, but he gets mentioned actually in several places. Acts 20 and 4 says that he's from the province of Asia. He gets mentioned in Ephesians. He gets mentioned in 2 Timothy. He gets mentioned in Titus, and he's always doing the same job. He's always carrying Paul's letters here, there, and everywhere. He was Paul's mailman. Tychicus was somebody Paul could lean on. And you remember Onesimus? Onesimus was the runaway slave from Philemon who ran away but ran into Paul. The Colossian church would know Onesimus because this was the very church that met in Philemon's home. Paul tells the Colossians, hey, Onesimus, he's one of you. He's the home team. He's my faithful and dear brother. And Paul's telling them that Onesimus is dependable. He's solid. He's somebody you can lean on. Paul says it's his express purpose in sending him that they will encourage. The word there is paraklesi. It's the same root word from where we get paraclete. It's one of the titles for the Holy Spirit. It means something that comes alongside to strengthen and to support. Paul's desire is to strengthen and support and build up this little band of believers there in the Lycus River Valley, but he can't be there, so he trusts Tychicus and Onesimus to encourage these believers on his behalf. Paul knew that the Colossians, they needed somebody they could lean on because he needed people he could lean on. Listen, Paul was an amazing individual. He was educated in the Greek philosophical system and the Hebrew scriptures. He was a student of Gamaliel, who was one of the premier rabbis of the first century. He was skilled in tent making, which was a lucrative profession. He made at least 4 missionary journeys. He ministered in the power of the Spirit, miracles, signs, and wonders following, and he couldn't do it all on his own. He couldn't do it by himself. And listen, if Paul couldn't do everything on his own, if he couldn't do life and carry out his ministry on his own, neither can you, and neither can I. There's no such thing as solitary Christianity. It's not a solo thing. You need some people to lean on, because the walk gets long sometimes. Way gets rough sometimes. You're going to need somebody who can come along and walk with you and strengthen you and encourage you. Listen, this house is a place where you can find some people to lean on. It's okay to not always be strong. You don't always need to be strong. You know, the late songwriter Bill Withers, he grew up in a little coal mining town called Slab Fork, West Virginia. Grew up in a decrepit little house in a poverty-stricken neighborhood. It was the sort of place where you knew that you needed people that you could lean on. And you knew that some of these folks might need to lean on you, too. Well, he had moved to L.A. He was writing for his second album, and he was feeling a little homesick for that strong, supportive community that he had known. And he was in the studio, sitting at the piano, and the lyric came to him, "Lean on me when you're not strong." It wasn't an idealized vision of what a community could be. It was a practical consideration in the community that he came from. He said, who could argue with the fact that it would be nice to have somebody who was really that way? But he said, my experience was there really were people who were that way. Let's be a place where people experience that. Let's be the strong, supportive community God has called us to be. Let's be a place where people can find somebody to lean on, where people experience family, where you can find a Tychicus or an Onesimus when you need them. You know, folks often view Paul as this singular, towering figure, single-handedly evangelizing the known world of his day. But Paul always had help, not just Onesimus and Tychicus. There was a lot more. Listen, if you're going to do a great work for God, it takes a team. It takes a team. Look here at verses 10 through 14. He talks about Aristarchus and Mark, Jesus, who's called Justice, all of these names that are there. Acts 19:29 says that Aristarchus traveled with Paul. He's from Macedonia. He might have been a convert from Paul's Macedonian mission. This Mark here is John Mark, who became the assistant of Peter, who wrote the Gospel of Mark. But Jesus, who's called Justice, he's only mentioned here. Don't know much else about him. These three, they're Jewish, like Paul. But then Paul also had co-workers who were Gentiles. There's Epaphras that you remember from chapter 1, who was the pastor of this evidently multi-campus church there that met in Colossae and Laodicea and Hierapolis. Yeah, there was him too. There was Nympha, who allowed the believers in Laodicea to meet in her house. You know, I don't tell you about all these names so that you can win on in Bible trivia. Why do I tell you all this? In fact, why bother including all of these little-known names, these obscure folks, as inspired scripture? Because there was a big family that Paul was a part of, and everybody had a part to play. And you know, this long list of names here, there's still some spaces on the list. It's an open list. You can add your name to the list. Some of them were Gentiles, some of them were Jews, there were men, there were women, they were from different places. Some are famous, some wrote books of scripture, some are only mentioned here, and some are known to God alone, but they opened their homes, they delivered letters, they strengthened, they encouraged. This diverse group of people that we usually don't talk about much, and yet the Holy Spirit, inspiring Paul to write, superintending the process, made sure that they all got mentioned. They were all important to Paul and to those first churches and to what God was doing in their generation. Boxing is an intensely individual sport, but every boxer has a corner team. A boxer's corner is that one-minute sanctuary between the physical battle of each round. And when a boxer comes to the corner, he's got a manager that's there to coach him. That's there to tell him, hey, here's how you need to approach that next round. He's got a corner man who provides the boxer with water and fluids, make sure he's hydrated and ready to go. And then he's got a cut man who's there to perform first aid. And without that corner team, the fight ain't going to last long. It can't go on. These people were Paul's corner team. They knew how to encourage him for the next round. They knew how to provide first aid when he was hurt, sometimes literally. When Paul was wounded, they knew how to refresh his spirit. You need to have a corner team. You need to get a corner team. You need to have some people that you can go to when you're hurt. Some people who know how to refresh and renew your spirit. Some people who can encourage you to keep going, to keep fighting. And you need to get on somebody's corner team. Because you and everyone you know is in a fight. My heart is that this house would be a corner for people. That it would be that sanctuary from the fight, a place to get what you need for the next round, a place where you can come when you're hurt, a place when life has dealt you some uppercuts and some body blows, you can come in here and experience some healing. I want you to leave out from Sunday morning worship with some hope, with some healing. I want you to leave up fired up and encouraged and ready for the bell that's going to ring on Monday morning, because it's coming. And Paul's going to offer us a little bit more coaching in these final verses. He reminds the Colossians, just with these final verses, the way that he puts it is that we're going to keep our priorities straight. Look at verses 15 through 18. He talks about, give my greetings to the brothers and sisters at Laodicea and to Nympha. And after this letter's been read to you, make for sure that you get it read in the church of the Laodiceans and read, in turn, the letter from Laodicea. You know, he says in 18, he says, I write this with my own hand. Remember my chains. Some pastors might wear suits and robes and stoles and other regalia as symbols of their authority. In 2020, some pastors might wear skinny jeans and overpriced tennis shoes as a sign of their authority, the mark of their credibility. But Paul wore chains. Now, Paul's chains, that hardship that he's enduring, it's an indicator that he and his message are the real thing. It's the genuine article. He's calling attention not to his hard situation, but he's calling attention here to his authority because they need to know who it is that they're connected to and who's speaking to them. When he says, remember my chains, he's not looking for sympathy. He's looking for obedience. So you notice that Paul has given two commands for the whole church. When he offers this imperative that the Colossians give his greetings to the brothers and sisters in Laodicea, it's not a throwaway line. It's not just tell them hi for me. Remember, Paul is in prison. He misses fellowship with other believers. He misses time with other people. He wants to ensure that the Colossians don't take that for granted. You know, we've been in this time of quarantine and distancing for just a few months, and many of us are missing the kind of fellowship that we once took for granted. But Paul's in prison in the first century in Ephesus. We have resources that Paul never dreamed of. We can call, we can text, we can Zoom, we can gather in smaller groups with social distancing. We can figure it out. We can listen, don't get so caught up wishing for things to go back the way they were that you miss the opportunity that's here and now. Somebody needs you, and if you're honest about it, you need somebody too. Paul says, greet the brothers and sisters for me. Prioritize that fellowship and see to it that my letters get read. That early church was already reading Paul's letters and the Gospels alongside Old Testament scripture. And the churches at Laodicea and Colossae, they're supposed to exchange letters. They're going to read one another's mail. When we read letters like Colossians, we're reading somebody else's mail. The reason that we prioritize reading Scripture together is because when we do, we learn how God dealt with people in the past. We learn how God spoke with people in the past, and that helps us to discern some things about how God wants to deal with us now and how He wants to speak with us now. So prioritize the place of the Word. Prioritize fellowship and prioritize the Word together. There's one last guy in here. What? One last name. He gets singled out. He gets some special attention. Now, we don't know who Archippus was. Don't know what his ministry was. But this singular instruction from Paul, it seems to suggest that he must have been tempted to quit. I don't know, maybe it was hard work. Maybe he had gotten discouraged. Maybe he wasn't seeing much in the way of results from what he was doing. He wasn't sure if it was worth it anymore. Maybe Archippus thought his role didn't matter because it was small. Maybe he thought that he wasn't important. But Paul says, no, no, no. See it through. Because it's from the Lord. Don't get fooled into thinking that what you've been called to isn't important. Don't think that it's too small. Don't get discouraged because the role seems small or the return on investment seems low. No, no, no. Listen, whatever it is that you've been given to do, it's from the Lord. It's from the Lord. That's why you keep at it. That's why you keep on going. You keep at it. You don't get discouraged. Don't give up. It's from the Lord. And then he's got one last line, just one last sentence. He says, grace be with you. Grace be with you. He's signing off now. I am too. This is my close. Paul says, grace be with you. The last word of the letter, it's the same as the first word of the letter. Grace. It was where we started, was with grace. Where we're finishing is with grace. From start to finish, it's all grace. Listen, it's what we all need. Then and now, in the first century, in 2020, it's grace. It's what we need over there in Colossae, and right here in Corsicana, grace. It's the only thing that makes the Christian life possible at all. It's grace. It's grace. It's what we all need is grace. Paul knew that if the Colossians were going to make it through the difficulty that they were facing, he knew that it was going to be by grace. Listen to me. Our church is 86 years old. We're 86 years old. A 23-year-old preacher and 96 founding members in the middle of the Great Depression started a gospel mission, and we've seen it through by grace. We didn't make it because our pastors were so smart or because our people were so gifted. We're still standing here today by grace. We've been through some highs and some lows, but it's been grace that kept us. We've been through on some hills and we've been on some valleys, but it's grace that kept us. We've been through times of plenty and times of need, but it's been grace every step of the way. Here we are today, still standing 86 years later, and it's by grace that we're still here. Oh, but what about you? What about you? Is there anybody in here that can look back over your life today and you say, you know what? I see it now. It was all by grace. It was grace that bought me. It was grace that kept me. It was grace that delivered me. Grace that healed me. I'm talking to somebody that's been through some lean seasons and some tough times. But let me tell you, you're still standing. You're still standing here today, and it's by grace. Somebody in here, you're sitting here next to a spouse, and there was some times that you didn't know that you would be able to stay married at all, but here you are today, still standing, and it's by grace. I'm talking to somebody in here, your change is strange. Your dollars are making you want to holler because it's awfully low at the bank, but here you are, still standing, and it's by grace. Some of you have kids that were acting crazy and you didn't know what was going to happen to them, but now here they are with you in the house of God. You're still standing, and it's by grace. Come on, is there anybody with me today? I'm talking to somebody who you were down to your last. You thought you would have been taken out of here, but grace came in. I'm sorry, if you can't get excited about grace, you can't get excited about anything. I'm going to preach this for my own self today. It's grace every step of the way. It's that unmerited favor that God's given us. Is there anybody in here today that can praise God for grace? Come on, I dare you. Take 10 seconds and give Him glory for grace. It was grace. Amazing grace.